assistant professor at IIIT Bangalore. My co-authors, Bharat and Harsha, they are practitioners of serious games. So they design serious games and try to conduct serious games and improve serious games. So my background is more in terms of computer vision and multimedia analysis. So I'm going to talk about how these techniques could be useful for serious game design. Okay. And just to give you, let's say, a concrete example. So here is a serious game being played. It's called an energy game. We have a sample session here. We have three groups of people. So you have, let's say, this one group, there's another group, and there's another group, let's say. So there are three different groups, and these are abstractions of, let's say, departments, coal, atomic energy, renewable energy, and so on. And the goal of the group is designing energy policy for the country. And as you can see, one can think about these as groups of small groups. You have conflict, cooperation among groups, conflict, cooperation, let's say across groups. So in the sense, within group there is conflict and cooperation, across groups there is conflict and cooperation, and so on, right? And so for a serious game designer, what are his goals? His goal is to use game elements to maximize learning. And for example, in this case, it is to create awareness about the energy scenario of the country and how we are investing in different energy sources and what would be the cost of it, what would be the emissions, and so on. So that is, let's say, how the game is designed so as to create awareness. And also to abstract realities so that it is as close as possible to the real situation, but then it has to have a game element so that people enjoy playing. So what we are going to talk about is more towards analyzing the game aspect. So game design is the prerogative of the game designers. We are not getting into that. We just look at the analytical part of game design, where let's say you have a game session for which let's say there are game design elements that are used in a game session, and then quantitative and qualitative data which is being generated from a game session, right? And then there's all, so this is the analytical dimension, and here is the design dimension. And after conducting a game designer collects these quantitative and qualitative data so as to give a feedback towards iterative game design, right? So what are these qualitative and quantitative data? We'll come to it. And so the goal is through this process the participants come out with learning, and also if one thinks of these groups and so on, so if these are organization, then you have a changed organization. Okay, so let's look at, for example, the quantitative data that is collected could be of this form, where in the first round how people have distributed their let's say the money on different energy sources, and then over time it just changes as people, as the game progresses. And there are various game elements like messages and information that is passed, so as to influence the game. So what is of interest to us is the qualitative data, right? Which is to do with game observation. In the sense that, for example, some of the observations that a manual observer does is, for example, he could observe that group one, let's say this is group one, Department of Atomic Energy had heavy discussions, or individual two in group three was negotiating with group two and was quite influential. Okay. So also in individual three in group two was dominating and disturbing and so on. So you have these qualitative observations which are actually fed back so as to improve the game design. So here is where the need for behavior analysis of, let's say, group dynamics is very useful. And that is what is, let's say, the topic on which I would like to focus on, and which is also, I think, interesting to this audience because it's slightly different from the, let's say, the usual, let's say, tone of the presentations. So here, what we have is behavior, which is multimodal audio-visual analysis of group interaction. So using videos, we exploit both the audio and visual analysis of group interactions. So how does one fit this with, let's say, social psychology literature? So social psychology literature, which has studied human communication, we know that there are different channels of information when human-human communication happens. It's also referred to as body language, posture, appearance, head movements, hand movements, eye movements, facial expression, and so on. And typically, the way behavior is coded is manual. Let's say in the traditional literature, where somebody looks at every frame of an interaction, and looks at the eyes and, let's say, marks if it is open or closed and so on. So this is for the eyes, nose, mouth, head, gaze, and so on. And what is being spoken, let's say, by one participant and another participant. Okay, so this is very time consuming. I mean, every frame one has to look at these behaviors and then annotate them. So what is new is, thanks to human-centered sensing and machine learning technologies, signal processing and machine learning technologies, it's possible to observe humans. Let's say this is an array microphone, both from an audio point of view, this is a wearable badge that people could use, or a Kinect image plus depth camera or Google glasses. So it is possible to observe humans in a very non-intrusive way. So that is one message. And one can pose human-centered signal processing problems. For example, one could automatically, by looking at a video of a person, let's say, walking or a person interacting with others, we know who this person is by using face recognition. What does he say? Let's say speech recognition. Where is he going to? What is the environment? Where is he? And so on. Right. So all these can be posed as a series of signal processing or machine learning problems, and then it is possible to do an automatic analysis of the interaction, right? So you can know who is speaking and where he is looking at and so on. And thanks to machine learning formulations, it is possible to do this in a, let's say, a training data set and a test data set type of framework, where for a collection of let's say data set, which is called a training data set, we give the labels, in the sense, like, for example, observations could be visual features that are collected from an image, and the label could be what the person is looking at, right? What is this, whether he is looking at the table or is he looking at a nearby person and so on. So I'll show you some videos for this. So the broad framework is the following. So you have the sensing sensors, with cameras and microphone arrays and so on. It is possible to track behavior of people. So who speaks, who looks at whom, who nods, and so on. And then it is possible to summarize the cues, let's say speaking, looking, gesturing, styles, and so on. And then it is possible to also build a probabilistic model of, if somebody behaves like this, how will they be perceived? For example, will that person be perceived as a dominant person or a leader, or is he trying to negotiate and so on, right? So you can build models of how people will be perceived. And behavior tracking itself is also very useful in the sense if you want to know what exactly a person is doing at every frame. And if you think about it, the automation has allowed one to not, I mean, instead of doing the manual coding, one can do it automatically. Of course, this is a work in progress in the sense it's not completely accurate, but for some of the conclusions that one wants to draw at a very coarse level, these are fairly good enough. And so I will show you a couple of videos which illustrate this point. So in this case, what is being shown here is the head is being tracked for a particular person. Red and green represent two different outputs. T1, T2, T3, T4, T5 are the targets where that person is looking at. T1, T2, T3 are the three participants. This is T3, and T1, T2 are sitting opposite to these two people. So here you have a web camera, and here you have a microphone array, which can tell who speaks when. And using this camera, we are trying to track the head of a person, and then estimating the pan and tilt, what is the pan and tilt of the person, and then finally assigning it to what target that person is looking at. T4, T5 are the table areas. So T4 is just here, T5 is here. And so the formulation involves a model like this. At every frame, you have some observations and then try to find out what is the position of that head is, what is the position of the head, and also what is the pose of the head, right? So we'll not get into the detail, but I'll just show you the video. So T4 is the table area that he's looking at. And UN is unfocused. So here, this is an example where we show the gaze tracking, in the sense we are tracking a particular behavior, which is to do with the gaze. So here is another example where the orientation of a person, where he's moving and where is his head. So both the body as well as the head orientation is shown. And so what we shown in this is behavior tracking. Behavior perception is to do with given that somebody's behavior is in a certain way. For example, in this we track the gaze of a person, and we estimate the dominance level of a person, and try to summarize of the group as such.
Okay.
Yeah.
What do you mean?
So here, what is shown is again similar to the previous one. You have a head bounding box where a person is looking at. You have four people: A, B, C and D, and A is looking at B. B is actually standing here, not visible. And this is showing when somebody speaks, there's this box, transparent box that comes up. And here in this part, we summarize the cues. For example, we summarize how much time A, B, C, D speak, how many interruptions each of them make. And the visual focus of attention tells how much somebody is being looked at. So for example, B is being looked at the most as of now. And then using these cues, we try to estimate what is the dominance level of each of the people. And moving from here to here is based on machine learning, in the sense we have collected data where we have the features and also the estimated dominance, which comes from human annotators. So that is acting as a ground truth, so that given a new interaction, you can analyze that interaction, track the behavior, summarize the cues, and then you can predict what is the estimated dominance.
Take over power. Okay, so special edition, linear access, random access, and there's post question. So the button are for special navigation.
Yeah,
so we have a remote control, very hard for that.
So here you see finally, so it turns out that C is the person who is the most dominant, and he is also interrupting others a lot. So let's conclude the presentation. So here in this presentation, we argue that there is a need for automatic observation. For example, which could be useful in summarizing, let's say, a whole serious game session, and also querying in the sense that we have a manual observer who just looks at all the interactions and makes notes. He can miss many of the micro event that happens. So if you have infrastructure to record the meetings, you can always go back and also summarize the interaction, so that you can look for specific things that you are looking for. And so in order to do automatic behavior analysis, one should look at speech to know who speaks when, to whom, interruption, negotiation, word usage, dialogue acts, and so on. So this is a work in progress. There's some things which are fairly accurate, some things which are still challenging, and so on. And in video, one has to see who looks at whom, who guesses what, and so on. And some of the challenges, for example, what I've shown you was a small group interaction. It is just a small group, whereas in some of the serious game situation, you have a group of groups. So there could be multiple groups, and it is essential to cancel speech interference from other groups. And there is also possibility for occlusion and so on. So the whole behavior tracking problem is quite challenging in the setting of serious games. So there is a lot of work to be done in multimedia analysis for adapting the technologies that have been developed in a small group setting to a group of group setting.